Good morning, everybody. Thank you for attending this talk this morning. We have today our talk titled Prospectivity of Heavy Oil in Colombia, Middle Magdalena, Llanos, and Putumayo Basins. Our speaker is Iván Olaya. I'm going to give you some more details. We had the originally scheduled the talk of Jet to Find by Cesar Mora, but unfortunately Cesar is sick. Don't worry, we will have that talk later in our following workshops. We are glad to tell you that after a big effort, I mean, we have covered the cycle number one. We started early in April, and we ended at cycle one in June 4th, covering most of the basins that where the blocks are being offered. And we started the cycle two in middle June, and we are ending up our second cycle today with our talk on heavy oil. And we are glad to announce that we will start, before that, just between cycle one and cycle two, we presented, or we were part of 13 technical workshops. And now we, 17. And now we are starting cycle three, and our goal is to have 13 more. So we will have in total 30 workshops before our petroleum summit on November 17th. A big effort from the ANH. And I'm glad to announce that next week we will start the last cycle with a lot of effort in order to promote the incorporation of areas in the round, and also call the attention of the areas offered by the agency directly. So what we are going to do in that cycle three, I mean, we are going to review the opportunities in the Caribbean, in the Caribbean basins. We also tell you basin by basin, what are the updates from our interpreters. Also, we will mention to you or describe to you what are the specifications of the nominated areas. As you know, we have 28 blocks or areas offered by the agency and 5 offered nominated by the industry. We will try during those following weeks to illustrate to you the technical specification of those nominated areas. But we have a very good news for you. As part of those workshops, during the third cycle, we will present to you all the, we call it discover and develop reservoir, all areas that have had production historically, and those areas has been given back to the ANH. So we are going to have basin by basin, we will illustrate to you those opportunities on weekly basis, okay? We will list the opportunities week by week. So you will prepare, we will cover all those opportunities in the Sinú San Jacinto, Lower Mac, Middle Mac, Llanos. And we will also have, during those this third cycle, we will have a very interesting presentation by ION, the company that is doing the microclimate project in the Caribbean Sea. And the ION is going to present to you all their findings and PST, pre-stack time migration. They have done that work, and we will have them on September 10 presenting the result of that reprocessing. So we will, as I mentioned, we will continue telling you about the nomination and the already discovered and developed reservoirs on the Llanos and in the Upper Mac and Catatumbo as well, and in the Lower Mac. And And also we will talk about the Paleozoic. I mean, we in the country, we will have the geological survey with us. We will have also Alejandro Mora from Hocol talking about their experience in the Lower Mac. So we have a very interesting third cycle. So in addition to that, we are going to mention to you the project that MinCiencias is doing with some research companies in Colombia, all of them supported economically by the agency. So all that group of eight research projects are going to be shown to you in one of those talks on February, on October 15th. Okay, so we hope to have on November 12th a closure, give you a summary of the 30 workshops that day before our summit. Okay, as I mentioned to you regarding this bank of opportunities on already undeveloped reservoirs, I mean, so we have more or less a total of 40 opportunities there. You see here in this map in red, the one that are being offered in this round as blocks offered by the agency directly. And in green color, you see the one that are already in or open acreage or available for you. And those are all of them, 40 gas and oil opportunities are going to be illustrated to you by the agency interpreter team during the following weeks. Okay, don't forget that we are working very hard for our students, for our group of young geologists and petroleum engineers. And we hope to have good news shortly in September regarding the economical support for those students in preparation of their thesis. Okay, so on frontier areas, Caribe, Chocó onshore, offshore, Tumaco onshore, and offshore, Caucapatía, Caguán, Cordillera, those are only that's only the requirement to focus on those areas. Well, as I mentioned earlier, I mean, we have the pleasure to have instead of Cesar Mora today, we have Dr. Iván Olaya, that is going to talk about the prospectivity of heavy oil in Colombia, specifically in the Middle Magdalena, Llanos, and Putumayo basins. Our talk today is only for 1 hour due to the change plans, but we will be back with a couple of hours next week. So I'm going to invite Iván to project, please. Okay, let me just talk a little bit about Iván for the people that do not know Iván. Dr. Iván Olaya is a geologist, graduated from the U.S. University, Master of Science in Geology from the Colorado School of Mines, Master of Business Administration, MBA, Universidad de los Andes, Specialist in Exploration Geophysicist, from the Colorado School of Mines, Specialist in Management from the Universidad de los Andes, Specialist in International Management of Hydrocarbon, also from the Universidad de los Andes. Iván has had experience in Ecopetrol 17 years, Ocol 2 years, Pacific Rubiales 8 years, Manzaro Bar Energy 4 years. And he is a volunteering in the APG Latin America visiting geologists, ACGGP Colombian visiting geologists, Bull Scout Colombia. He is the Bull Scout currently in Colombia. And he was president of the ACCGP from 2010 to 2011. Guest speaker in topics such as seismic interpretation, sequence stratigraphy, advanced petroleum geology in many faculties of Latin America, author of lecture series, Tour Sismico for several bases in Latin America. It's a pleasure to have Iván, and the agency is very grateful with him. for all his contribution to promote our areas in the country. Welcome, Ivan.
Thank you, Miguel. Thank you for the invitation today. We hope that César will be next week here with his talk. Okay, today we will talk about the heavy oil. All the compilation, the public confirmation that I did for this talk is about the Llanos, about the different areas in Llanos, because the heavy oils in the Llanos are different. There are like at least two areas. Okay, the agenda for today, as always, we will start with a regional description, with a regional framework describing the setting, the regional setting for Colombia, where we have heavy oil in Colombia. And of course, a hypothesis of how we can predict the future heavy oil discoveries in Colombia using several geophysical techniques. And after that, we will start describing each basin. I mean, in Llanos, we will start describing all the eastern area that is associated with Rubiales, Quifa, Riariari type, and the Castilla, Acacias, Chichimene area that is located in the west part, in the west part of the Llanos. We will see that the heavy oils are different in both areas. We will try to explain what is the causes or the for that difference. We will continue with the Caguán Basin, especially in the Capela area. And then we will start with the Putumayo, and we will finish with the Middle Magdalena Valley. And of course, the conclusion and recommendation about this talk. Then let's start where we have heavy oils in the country, in Colombia. Of course, we will start with Llanos. The Llanos Basin is the main producer of heavy oil in Colombia. I took this Halliburton map. Is the AP gravity map for the Llanos Basin, and you can see the contour of 15 API that is considered in Colombia. Less than 15 in AP gravity is considered the heavy oil. You can see analyzing this map, Rubiales is in this position. And all the Chichimene, Castilla, Acacias, CPO Night Block are located in the southwest corner of the Llanos Basin. And you will see that there are two anomalies, at least two anomalies for heavy oil. Look at that in this is the boundary between Casanare and Meta. Here you have the Pastinaca discovery from Ecopetrol, close to the Negritos and Camoa discoveries in this area, and also some other anomaly of heavy oil in this part in the boundary between Casanare and Meta blocks, and also you can see a light oil anomaly in this area. The explanation for that is you know that some the hypothesis is a refresh migration time recently to get this point here, but in general we will assume that the main heavy oil accumulations are in the far from the Eastern Cordillera, and the hypothesis, or the most accepted hypothesis for the existing of of Rubiales and this heavy oil belt is that the crude, the heavy oil crude existed in, for example, in Rubiales, the origin is that was migrated, the originally was a light oil, and during the migration from the kitchen that is the Eastern Cordillera today to Rubiales was biodegraded by the subsurface fresh waters, and that produced the heavy oil that we have in Rubiales. That's the most accepted hypothesis for the heavy oil existing in Rubiales. We will see that Castilla probably is the origin is not like a Rubiales. We will see that later. And then that's for Llanos. Now for Middle Magdalena. In Middle Magdalena, you can see here that's the 15 AP gravity. This is from Gilbert Gutierrez and Mario Suarez in 2001. Is the mirror image from Llanos. I mean, when I say mirror image means that in Llanos, the heavy oil are in the eastern border of the basin. Here in the Middle Magdalena, the heavy oil accumulation are in the western border of the basin. Again, as Llanos, in the Middle Magdalena, we assume that the kitchen or the oil generation is below the current Eastern Cordillera location, and the migration is, in this case, in the Middle Magdalena, is from east to west. Remember that in the Llanos was from west to east. The main heavy oil fields in the Middle Magdalena are an area that is operated by Manzarrobat, and Teca Coconada that is operated by Ecopetrol with Sierra Coal is helping in the operation of this field. Okay, and now look at the distribution of the AP gravity by basin. Here is the Llanos Oriental Basin. In the vertical, you have the AP gravity from 6 to 18. In the horizontal, you have the fields, the names of the field in alphabetic order. I mean, there is no a specific in the horizontal axis. This is the ICP the ICP job in 2001. And the horizontal is just alphabetic order. I mean, it's not a specific property of the heavy oils. You will see that, for example, Chichimene, Castilla are around 10, 12, probably 14. Is this area? And Rubiales is 12 to 14. There is an anomaly here, but in general, the Rubiales AP gravity is around 12 to 14. Castilla, okay, Chichimene is around between 10 to 11. Almagro, here this is from 2001, but probably Pastinaca and the last discoveries in the meta area are around the 10 to 12 AP gravities. In the middle Magdalena, you have, for example, look at the northern part of Middle Magdalena. I mean, all the Los Angeles and Pavas are in this is the extra heavy oil area. I mean, less than 10 AP gravity is extra heavy oil. There in that category are the Los Angeles, Cocorná. Look at the Cocorná, some of the Cocorná. This is an anomaly because the main Cocorná wells or oils are in this, are around 12 AP gravity. For example, jasmine. Jasmine is one of the fields in the that Nare area. And look at the jasmine and the all the wells, all the fields in the Nare area are around also to 12 AP degrees AP gravity. Similar to Cocorna. In Putumayo, look at the okay. In Caguán Putumayo, the most famous is Capela, heavy oil field, and it's also around 14. Is some Umbria, for example. This is from the ICP. Umbria is a extra heavy oil. It's less than 10. But look at for example, the Quillancinga, Mirador, all the Putumayo wells are in that heavy oil range in the Putumayo wells. Then with all in this moment we know or you know where and the AP gravity that we have in that three basins. I mean mainly Llanos, Middle Magdalena, and Putumayo. Now, how to predict where we will have future discoveries, and what are the actions that we have to do to discover that future fields? Then, for that, to solve that question, I choose the gravity map as a tool to know how is the regional configuration of the northern South America basin, and I started to put the heavy oils fields in that map. Look at the Sabanero, Rubiales, El Miedo. Okay, El Miedo is around 18 AP gravity. I mean, it's not properly heavy, but it's in that area. Sabanero, Rubiales, Amaca, Frontera, Rio Ariari also from Frontera, Capela from Emerald. Solita well, we will talk about Solita at the end of this presentation. All the ITT complex heavy oil in Ecuador, and also the last discoveries in Peru by Perenco, associated to the block 67. I mean, Piraña, Delfín. Okay, there are several fields in this area is also associated to the Iquitos search. Then what is the common feature that joins that fields? Then I selected this contour, I mean this color in this map. Look at that. It's interesting to see the this contour how to join most of these heavy oils in Colombia, in Ecuador and Peru. But of course, we have heavy oils fields that doesn't match don't match in this map. One of these is Castilla. We will analyze Castilla, why we have an important amount of heavy oil in a trend different than this trend that we are proposing in the as the North America, the North South America heavy oil belt. We will detail an analysis in Castilla, and also of course in all the Magdalena, the Middle Magdalena basin is not in that belt. Then, let's start to analyze basin by basin. Let's start to analyze the current heavy oil, the existing heavy oil fields in each basin, and what we can predict from that current fields, how we can predict the future discoveries or the future accumulations, the future heavy oil fields in each basin. Let's start with Llanos Basin. Let's start with Rubiales. We will start with the Rubiales case, of course. And this is a northwest southeast of the Rubiales. And looking the or doing a fast seismic stratigraphic interpretation, you will see there is an on-lap. This is the reservoir in the basal. The basal sands are the reservoir in Rubiales, and you also will see there is a erosional truncation below for that Paleozoic. This is the Paleozoic strata, sedimentary rocks or metasedimentary rocks in some cases. And analyzing the seismic configuration for the reservoir, you will see that probably you don't have a continuous sand. You will have probably a different compartment and different ages in the reservoir. In Rubiales, we shoot a high resolution 3D survey, and to map the what is the limit for that accumulation. We did a horizon slide at the top of the production level. That is more or less the production level is more or less this feature that you can see here, and in that horizon slide you can easily see what is the on-lap, the pinch out of the reservoir in the area. And that's a fast way to know where that you have the heavy oil accumulation from this line to the west. I mean, from this line to the east, you don't have a net pay, or you don't have a heavy oil accumulation in this case in the Rubiales. And look at this feature here. I mean, it's probably a river coming to this it's a continental environment. I cannot see is a river coming to the sea, but it's in this area is interesting because in this area you have the best sand shale ratios in the Rubiales field and in general in the Rubiales and Quifa area. And then that's the lesson learned in this case in Rubiales. Using this technology, we can map what is the limit for the heavy oil accumulation. We need this technology in Middle Magdalena. We don't have this in the southern Middle Magdalena. We don't have this technology in Putumayo to map, for example, the heavy oil accumulation that we have there. We need this technology there. Okay. Second case, Quifa. Quifa was discovered in 2000. The Quifa one was in 2003, and in 2008 when Pacific acquired this block, we did a stratigraphic analysis trying to understand what is the best or the stratigraphic model in this field. The initial model was a lithostratigraphic correlation from from the different in the different Rubiales wells. And in that case, for example, this is Rubiales X well, and this is Rubiales Y. And as the initial model was a litrostratigraphic correlation, that means they say, okay, this sand is exactly this one, then you can correlate in this way. And of course, you have oil water contact here, you have a gold water contact here, and then you have a tilted oil water contact. That was the initial stratigraphic model in the Rubiales field. Then analyzing the seismic, of course, doing a sequence stratigraphic analysis, of course, we discovered that the each sand or the there are different compartments in the field. Then we change our correlation using the high resolution seismic 3D seismic. We change the model for this one. I mean, in the upper part of the Rubiales field is not connected with the lower part of the Rubiales field. I mean, that changes that the consequence of this new model. We can raise the production from 14,000 barrels to more than 200 barrels per day in 2012-2015. But the most important consequence of this was not to increase the production of Rubiales. The most important was to discover the Quifa field. Because analyzing the seismic, we say, okay, probably we have in the lower part of the lower part of the Rubiales field, we have the same configuration. And probably we have another compartment there. Yes. When I proposed to drill a well in the lower part of Rubiales, all the petroleum engineers say, Ivan, you are lower than the oil water contact, you will be in water there. Okay, we drilled the Quifa well, and we discovered the Quifa field that today is producing more than 60,000 barrels per day. I mean, and was a consequence of an stratigraphic analysis, and was a consequence to apply new technologies as a sequence stratigraphy analysis using a high resolution 3D seismic in the Rubiales field. Why I emphasize using a high resolution 3D seismic? Because in other areas, as Middle Magdalena, as Putumayo, as mentioned before, we don't have this technology there. And I mean, we probably have a good potential in the Middle Magdalena, good potential in Putumayo area, but we don't have the information to discover it. The second area in the Llanos is Rio Ariari sector. And the Rio Ariari block was initially discovered by Petro Minerales, and Petro Minerales was acquired by Pacific. In this sector, there is an interesting combination. This is the Eocene and conformity. I mean, from this green line above of that, you have all the tertiary sediments, and you have the Paleozoic strata below that green line. In the basal tertiary section, Petro Minerales, okay, Pacific Frontera today, they discovered the Rio Ariari field. I mean, it's a heavy oil accumulation in the basal sands of the basal tertiary sands in this area. But it's interesting, they also discovered a gas accumulation in the Paleozoic strata. Look at that. They have more than 600 feet of of gas column in this area. It's interesting. Look at that. The Calandria well is not in the best structural position. Azarina is in a better structural position, and in Azarina they got just 167 feet of gas column, because the look at that, the upper part of the gas zone are truncated, erosional truncated in this sector. That's why in Azarina you only have the basal producing zone that was founded in Calandria. Why is interesting to have gas and heavy oil? Because to produce most of these heavy oil accumulations, probably in the future we will need techniques as, for example, as we are using in Manzarrobar is using in Middle Magdalena, is injecting steam to increase the production of this heavy oil. That steam is produced, of course, from water and from gas, and you need gas to heat the water and to inject the steam in these reservoirs. So that means probably in this sector, this sector Rio Ariari is really far from all the gas infrastructure in Colombia, and probably you have here the gas to support secondary recovery process in these fields. I mean, free gas that support that the production of this behavior. Okay, let's move to the western part of the Llanos Basin. I mean, let's move to Castilla, to all the heavy oil fields that are in the Castilla area. Chichimene, Acacias, the last discovery was Lorito from the Copperol, and all the CPO nine block. And why Castilla is not in this trend? Then looking for the answer to that question, I found the ICP, the ICP report. They did in 2001, they did the analysis of the geochemical composition for most of the heavy oils in Colombia. You have here the Llanos, Putumayo, and Middle Magdalena, and look at the location of the Castilla and Chichimen, the main location of the Castilla and Chichimen, and the location of the other heavy oils in the Llanos. I just was to emphasize, look at the maduration. I mean, the Castilla and Chichimene fields are less mature than the other heavy oils in the Llanos. What is the explanation for that? I'm not a geochemical expert, but from my friend, from some of my friends, my geochemical advisors, they say probably the Castilla and Chichimene, the Castilla area heavy oil fields were generated before than at the beginning of the oil window. And in that, the beginning of the heavy, that oil window, the oil generated at heavy. I mean, Castilla in origin is heavy. Rubiales in origin is not heavy. Rubiales, the most accepted hypothesis of Rubiales is that was a light oil biodegraded during the migration, the 400 kilometers migration pathway from the Cordillera to the Rubiales accumulation. that produce, okay, in this moment, I am proposing a different origin for Castilla and for Rubiales. Of course, different composition. You can see in the ICP report, and of course, different exploration strategies for the heavy oils in the foothill and from heavy oils in the far areas than the Eastern Cordillera. We can apply that conclusion in the Putumayo and Caguán basins in the next slides. Different origins from Castilla and from Rubiales. And of course, you can apply also the same in the Middle Magdalena. We will see that later. Different origins from Nari and from the southern part of the Middle Magdalena. Okay, let's move to the Caguán Basin, to the Capela area. This is the report from the ICP in 1998, and you can see here the different. This is a northwest southeast section in this area, in this portion of the Colombia. You can see there the different wells. This is, for example, Piraña. Piraña was drilled in 1976, and the total depth is almost 4,000 feet. In the Losada one well, drilled in 1971, previous, the first well drilled in this area, and was the found the basement. Really shallow, I mean less than 2,000 feet depth in Lusada. Here is Payara. Payara was drilled in 1975, and Payara is located in the same structure than Capela. Capela was discovered in 2008, and of course the Capela drilled the same stratigraphic column than Payara. And is here is Chipo. Chipo was drilled is the most recent well drilled in this section. And drilled a structure like this. I mean, probably this is a positive flower structure. I mean, probably associated with some transcurrence on the striker slip movement in the area. Then, why you can see here that the different falls had more or less the same geometry. Then, what is the explanation of why this structure have accumulation and, for example, Piraña no, or Chipo no? Are all the falls have all the falls in this section have the same timing? Andres Mesa and Caterine Jaimes say in a technical workshop like 1 month ago that the some of these falls are inverted, and most of them has basal conglomerate in restricted areas, and that produce a different timing for the falls that you have here. I mean, for example, for me, my personal interpretation, Piraña, the fall of Piraña is a very recent structure, very recent fall, but the Payara fall is a reactivated or inverted fall in a recent time. I mean, Payara has a good timing for oil trapping. Piraña, no. Piraña is a very recent structure. I mean, very recent means that probably the trap time is more recent than oil migration time. And in that case, you have a dry structure in this in Piranha. That's my personal interpretation, and that explains why you have several wells drilled in a structure in similar geometry structure, and some of them you have production, and most of them you don't have production. Then you have put attention into the timing of the faults in areas as Capella. Let's move to Putumayo. In Putumayo, last year, Alvaro Vargas published his master degree thesis, and this is the top of the basement from the gravimetric inversion, and was a really good job. And look at that, this is a most detailed map compared with the map that they use, that regional map they use to define the North South America heavy oil belt. And it's interesting this map. Look at that. I put in this map, I put the most representative wells trying to understand the how is the oil migration and why wells as Lozada doesn't have production and Capella, yes. Capella is a discovery today. Look at that, the Capella is located in a height, in a paleo height, in this area. Probably I can extend this Alto de Caguán to this part, separating two basins. One basin in the eastern part is more associated with the Sierra de la Macarena from this small basin in this area. Interesting. That means that Capella is in a good structural position. Lozada is in the border of this basin, but probably we have to analyze more in detail this area. In this area, the Uribe one well that has a Cretaceous strata, you look at more or less in this position, then we have to analyze with this new model. We have to do redo the basin analysis that Cesar Mora and other friends showed one month ago. But we have to analyze. I want to analyze this sector. This is the I just concentrate my analysis in this well, Solita One. Look at that, Solita One. This is a southwestern northeast section. This is Solita. Solita was drilled in 1984, and the total depth is in 3,000. Around 4,000 feet. But what is the importance of Solita? Solita found a chose of heavy oil in all the basal section, in all this section. I will show you later. That's interesting because for example, the most closest or the near oil field in this area is Mandur, but Mandur. Look at the in Mandur, you have mainly a structural configuration. In Solita, the main trapping mechanism is stratigraphic. It's the pinch out of all this. This is the Pepino formation, and it's the pinch out of that formation here. Is producing the trap. I mean, it's a stratigraphic trap. Another analysis from this line. Look at the geometry of the basement, and look at how that geometry, or there is a change in that basement pattern in this section. I mean, probably in this area, we have Paleozoic sediments truncated by this unconformity. And in this area, probably you don't have that sedimentary Paleozoic rocks. Probably you have mainly intrusive, pre-tertiary intrusive bodies in this section. Why is important to analyze? What is the important to have a sedimentary or metasedimentary Paleozoic here and intrusive here? Because the intrusive has a higher temperature. That's for example, in Rubiales, Rubiales have a temperature anomaly in the at the reservoir level, and that produces generates that the production strategy in Rubiales is easy. I mean, you can produce the oil easily in Rubiales because it's a high temperature reservoir. But for example, in Amaca, we don't have that temperature anomaly. In Rio Ariari, we don't have that temperature anomaly. Then we need in Nare, for example, in the Middle Magdalena, the fields operated by Mansa Robar, we don't have that temperature anomaly. That's why we need to inject steam to facilitate or to stimulate the oil production, to increase the oil production in that field. Then it's important to analyze this or to define exactly if we can have a temperature anomalies in the reservoir, because that will increase, of course, the productivity of the wells in this area. Look at this correlation between Solita 1 and Rubiales 3. As the vertical scale is I just try to do the same vertical scale from these two wells. Of course, the well logs are not the same. You have here the SP SP log and the resistivity. Here you have this is gamma ray and resistivity logs. Look at that in Solita 1, they found oil shows almost in all the basal section. From you have here from around 3,400 feet more than 300 feet, fully impregnated with oil, heavy oil. In Rubiales, we only have the upper section filled with heavy oil. At Rubiales, the average thickness or heavy oil net pay is around 40-50 feet. In Solita, we have more than 300 feet. I mean, Solita is the impregnated column is more than five or more than six times the Rubiales field. I mean, it's interesting. It's interesting. This well, but we don't have the a 3D in this Solita area to define the limit of the accumulation, but we have the Vargas, the Álvaro Vargas, a high resolution inverted map. And look at that. If Solita here, you can follow this contour and you can define where the extension of that pinch out and of course the extension of that heavy oil accumulation in the northern part, in the eastern part of Putumayo. Look at it's interesting. We don't have wells in the southern part of in this part of the basin. We only have the closest the nearest field is Platanillo, Platanillo from Amerisur, okay, from your park. From your park is more or less in this position. I mean, it's really far, but we need at least stratigraphic wells to define the continuity of that heavy oil accumulation in Solita to define the continuity in the southern part. In the northern part, Nogal from Emerald, Nogal has also an important section impregnated with heavy oil. I don't have the information from that well, but I don't know exactly what is the net pay impregnated with heavy oil in Nogal, but I assume that it's more or less similar to Solita, probably not the 300 feet as in Solita, probably, but it's interesting all this area because you can have heavy oil accumulation similar to Rubiales. It's interesting. I mean, this is a huge area. I mean, look at you have here. This is a 100 kilometers. Okay, here you have probably 100, 200 kilometers of extension of this accumulation in this area. It's more than this distance between Rubiales and Amaca in the Llano Basin. This is an interesting area. Look at the comparison between the seismic response, the seismic geometry in Solita and the seismic geometry in Rubiales. Also in Rubiales, you look at the basement response as you can see here in some places in the Solita area, the change, as I mentioned it before, the change in the geometry of the basement in this area, probably associated with this strata here, pre-tertiary sedimentary strata, and probably you don't have that section here. Probably you have more igneous rock that's good because that increase the temperature in the reservoirs in Solita in this area. Okay, let's move to the Middle Magdalena. As I mentioned it before, this is the distribution of the Middle Magdalena oil gravities. The main accumulation are associated in Are, this section. Also, we have some in Los Angeles. In Los Angeles, we have also heavy oil that doesn't, the Los Angeles field doesn't correspond with this trend. I mean, you have to move this trend probably in this to this, or okay, you have to detail mapping in this area. But in the southern part, we only have the accumulation here, but we don't have, for example, in the southern part, we don't have oil fields discoveries in that area. Analyzing the distribution of the oil shows, the distribution of the oil fields in the Middle Magdalena. This map was from the UKIMI Atlas published by ANH in 2010. You will see easily that something is happening in this area. I mean, look at that. The different pattern in the, for example, the green dots, the green points here are oil shows. And look at that. From this line, you don't have that trend. You have the main oil discoveries in this area. Here in this sector, you don't have fields, you don't have discoveries. In this section, in this part, the trend of the basin is more or less south north, and from this line, the train of the field changed from south north in the southern part to south west to northeast. I mean, something is happening here. What is the geological explanation for that change? Then, reading several reports, I found the PhD thesis of my friend Luis Fernando Sarmiento, and he is proposing in this area, he is proposing the limit between two basins. He's proposing the southern limit of the Tablazo Magdalena subbasin. I mean, from this line to the south, we have a different basin than from this line to the north. And of course, what are the consequences of that? If you have a different basin, probably you have difference of rock for the oils in the northern part and in the southern part. You have different timings, as in Castilla and Rubiales. Remember that Castilla probably have a different timing than Rubiales. Castilla is what generated the heavy oils in Castilla, what generated during the first stage in the oil window, and Rubiales probably no, probably is in the more advanced stage in the oil window. That's the second consequence of have a different basin. And of course, if you have different basins, you also have different trapping mechanisms, probably. If you have different trapping mechanisms, you need a different exploration strategy from the northern part and from the southern part. But to do that, you need information. You don't have in the southern part, for example, you need a 3D survey to first understand the tectonic stratigraphy model, because probably in the southern part, in this area, you don't have a structural trap as in Velázquez, as in Palagua. Probably in this position, in this area, you have more stratigraphic traps. And to discover that, to understand that, you need a 3D survey. I mean, we need more information to understand where the subsurface accumulations in this area are. But of course, there is a petroleum system working, because look at all the oil shows that you have here, the heavy oil shows in this area. But we need more information, more data, more basic modeling to understand when this oil was generated, what are the main trapping mechanisms in the subsurface. I mean, we have a lot of uncertainties in this area. But in this moment, we know that it's a different by Luis Fernando Sarmiento, it's a different geological configuration, geological elements in the northern part than in the southern part. Okay, I just have 2 minutes. Okay, conclusions and recommendations. The main conclusion, we have a lot of tremendous potential for heavy oil in our country. What we learn, lesson learned from the existing or from the current producer fields? First, new ideas in all bases. And that was the main driver in Rubiales. If we apply new technologies or new ideas in Rubiales, we discovered Kifa, because it was the same trapping mechanism, but in the lower part. New heavy oil discoveries will be far from the Cordillera. For example, all the Solita, Nogal area or proposed heavy oil accumulations are flat from the Cordillera. That means hard access area, problem with security, problem with communities, and we have to be prepared for that. Is necessary acquisition of new data. We need, as I showed it in Rubiales, the 3D high resolution seismic surveys are necessary to map the stratigraphic trapping mechanism in Rubiales, also as in the southern Middle Magdalena, also in Putumayo. We need that technology to map the extension of that accumulation. We need new methodologies as seismic sequence stratigraphy, new technologies, as I mentioned before, 3D seismic, probably that high resolution gravimetric map as the Alvaro map that's a new technology, that's a good interesting technology to discover and to map the new discoveries. Where then, in conclusion, for this presentation, where are the future heavy oil discoveries? As I mentioned, Eastern Putumayo, all that section, that area between Solita to the south of Solita and to the north, going to Nodal, is a very interesting area for heavy oil accumulations. So there, Caguán, in the understanding the Capela, why Capela is a successful case and why Piraña no, then we can discover future heavy oils in the southern Caguán. So the Llanos Orientales, I mean the continuity of from Rubiales, no, starting from Sabanero, Rubiales, Caño Sur, East, Amaca, between Amaca and Rio Ariari, there is an area that can have additional heavy oil discoveries. Rio Ariari, and all the western area associated close to Castilla, CPO-9, and the recent discoveries of Pastinaca from Ecopetrol in the Camo area is also probably a future heavy oil prone area. In the Middle Magdalena Basin, of course, the southern part. But southern is from Velázquez to the south. But we need, in this moment, we have an hypothesis that there is a different basin in the southern part and in the northern part, but we need also new techniques and new data acquisition in that area. Okay, thank you, Miguel. I don't know if we have questions in the chat.
Ivan, three questions. The first one from Juan Pablo Reyes: why you didn't include the Uribe One well? Or are you familiar with the findings of Uribe One?
Yes, and Uribe One is a very interesting well. I mean, in the basal zone, in the Uribe well has Cretaceous strata, and of course it's upper Cretaceous, and of course it can be associated with the most prolific soft rock in the northern South America. I mean, La Luna. But as I mentioned, and there is a very interesting structure in Uribe One. The well Uribe One got oil shows in the basal section. But we need there is a 3D there. For me, Juan Pablo, there is a good opportunity in that area. the main problem there are the public order, the security. I don't know the my last time in Uribe was in 2012, and was a very difficult time in that because was the security there was different, was difficult in that area. But for me, Juan Pablo, I agree with you. There is a interesting potential in that area, and we need to model it that basin, that part of the with that new map from Alvaro, and to see the additional productivity in that area. But it's interesting, Juan Pablo. I agree with you. There is a interesting potential in there. In the Uribe and in that structure dealt by Uribe one.
Yes, Ivan, the second one. You didn't mention anything about the hydrodynamic component in Rubiales. Do you believe on that, or just it as a structural and stratigraphic trap?
No, the hydrodynamic. Well, in Rubiales, we have the three mechanisms working together: structural, stratigraphic, and hydrodynamic. Like 6 years ago, I asked to the Isidro Araujo, that was the manager for Rubiales, a petroleum engineer manager for Rubiales. I asked, what is the most important, structural, stratigraphic, or hydrodynamic? What is the most important in Rubiales? He say, okay, the stratigraphic, more or less, I understand the stratigraphic by the seismic and the structural. But we don't understand the hydrodynamic tropic in Rubiales. We know that there is there. We put a lot of pressure tools at the bottom of the wells, trying to map the hydrodynamic conditions, but it's difficult to understand the hydrodynamic. We know that it's there, but we don't know exactly the directions. We don't know exactly the how it's affecting that hydrodynamic to the production. It's interesting. We need more information. We need more analysis to understand what is the hydrodynamic effect in the Rubiales production. I don't have that information, but it's interesting. We know that it's there. We know that the hydrodynamic effect is there, but we need more data and more analysis to understand exactly how is the hydrodynamic behavior in Rubiales, and of course to extrapolate that to the rest of the llanos. For me, there is a important potential, remnant potential for hydrocarbon in los llanos, and it's more associated to stratigraphic traps and hydrodynamic traps, because almost all the structural traps were drilled already in the llanos, and the future potential in llanos is stratigraphic and is hydrodynamic traps.
Okay, Ivan, the last question. I mean, if I understood right, you say that in the Ariari River or in the Ariari area, the wells Calandria and Azarina, I understood that those wells, or one of those wells, found a gas column in the Paleozoic section. If I understood right, if that gas is located in the Paleozoic sequence, don't you think that is a proof that we have a hydrocarbon system already tested in the Paleozoic of the Llanos?
Yes, yes, Miguel. Yes, I think that there is important potential in Paleozoic, but we need more information, we need more analysis. I don't know if that the gas analysis can be included in the regional study, GAS regional study that ANH is doing with I think the university, the Sogamoso University is doing an analysis. I don't know if possible to include that GAS, because it's trying to understand the potential for the Paleozoic. But of course, as you say, we need more data, we need more analysis, because it's that section, Rio Areari, for me is not connected with the central part, with the northern part. I mean with the Arauca graben, of course, not connected with Rio Areari, but we need to understand what is the relation, the geological relation between that different gravens or that different Paleozoic strata in Llanos. But of course, I agree with you. There is important potential for me. There is important potential in Paleozoic that we need to explore in the future.
Perfect. Ivan, thank you very much. And for the more than 100 attendees this morning, thank you very much. See you next week with a very interesting workshop. We will send the announcement early in the week. Thank you very much.
Okay. Thank you. Bye.